George Washington was born February 22, 1732, on Pope's Creek Farm near the Potomac River in Westmoreland County, Virginia. He was the first of six children born to Augustine Washington and his second wife, Mary Ball Washington. The Washington family was industrious, respected, and relatively wealthy. George was to be educated in England, and he dreamed of going to sea with the British Navy. But everything changed in 1744 when Augustine died. At just 11 years of age, George became the man of the house. His education came from local schools and tutors. He learned to read and to write clearly, to keep books, and to prepare business documents. He taught himself social graces by copying a manual called Rules of Civility and Decent Behavior in Company and Conversation. George put particular effort into his studies of mathematics and surveying, and by 15, he was working as an assistant surveyor. In his early 20s, he acquired the family farm and was awarded his first military post, adjutant of one of four districts in Virginia. For George Washington, public service was his duty, but farming was his passion.
He was very good at it. In fact, many of his innovations in raising livestock and crops are still evident here at Mount Vernon, just south of Washington, D.C., his home for 45 years until his death in 1799. Washington was first a tobacco farmer, just like a lot of other Virginia planters. But in the mid-1760s, he was one of the first to switch to wheat. You see, Washington had this vision that one day America could become a source of grain to the entire world. Now, wheat farming back then was very labor-intensive. And one of the most back-breaking parts of the job was separating the grain from the straw. Now, this is where Washington got really creative. In 1792, he built a 16-sided, two-story treading barn, just like the one behind me, for this very purpose.
On the second floor, horses trotted around, trampling on the wheat and knocking the grain loose. The grain would fall through these cracks down to the first floor, where it would be collected.
Washington was creative about saving the soil, too. He rotated his crops on a 7-year plan, plowed his fields to minimize soil erosion, and he experimented with soil amendments. Here in this dung repository, he collected and composted horse manure to make fertilizer. Here at Mount Vernon, Washington raised sheep, hogs, turkeys, chickens, and cows. I think it's safe to say that he liked animals. But George Washington loved horses. He loved to buy them and sell them. He loved to race them and train them and hunt on them and drive them and work the fields with them. George owned all kinds of horses, from Arabians, Andalusians, and Narragansetts to Chincoteague ponies. But there weren't that many formal breeds in Washington's time, so many of his horses appear in his records as simply plow horses or carriage horses. Still, old George knew them all by name. George Washington was a revolutionary farmer, but it was the Revolutionary War that put him in the history books.
During the war, General Washington took two of his favorite horses to the front with him. One was a hunting horse called Blueskin, a spirited bluish-gray horse with a lot of stamina. Now, this is the light-colored horse you see in many paintings of Washington. But during most battles, Washington actually rode a horse named Nelson, a chestnut gelding that could supposedly handle cannon fire better. Back on the farm, Washington's favorite horse was an Arabian stallion named Magnolia, one of the most beautiful horses in the colonies. Magnolia stood 16 hands high, was chestnut with a flaxen mane and tail, and was a direct descendant of the Godolphin Arabian, one of the foundation sires of the thoroughbred breed.
At 6'2 and 200 pounds, Washington was a big guy, especially for his time, and he was a great rider.
He liked to train his horses himself, and he was good at that, too. Thomas Jefferson once called him the best horseman of his age. Endurance riders, listen to this. George Washington once rode his Shinkotique pony, Chinky, 147 miles from Mount Vernon to Williamsburg in a single day.
And mule lovers will appreciate this. The father of our country is also the father of the American mule. You see, George Washington believed that mules are the key to more profitable farming. They're stronger than horses, they eat less, they have greater endurance, and they're more sure-footed. So after the war, George Washington concentrated on breeding mules. He even gave up his prize stallion Magnolia to Cavalry General Light Horse Harry Lee, father of future Civil War General Robert E. Lee.
Washington's mule breeding program started with three stud donkeys, two of which were gifts from foreign leaders. Washington bred these jacks to his very best mares to produce some really nice mules. He also sent his studs on a tour of the South to start a selective breeding program. Soon, mules were in use across the country, working the land and serving the military. George Washington died on December 14, 1799, at the age of 67. Ironically, the great warrior, farmer, and statesman died of complications from a cold. This threw the country into despair, as Washington was universally loved and respected by his countrymen. His friend Henry Lighthorse Harry Lee captured popular sentiment in his eulogy for Washington, calling him first in war, first in peace, and first in the hearts of his countrymen. Almost immediately, writers began romanticizing Washington's life. Today, it's sometimes hard to separate fact from fable. For instance, the famous story of young George fessing up about chopping on a cherry tree? Pure fiction.
Yep, old George Washington was one interesting guy, and we all owe a lot to him.